Hello friends, right now I am with a very very important significant dignitary in the textile industry. I am currently in front of Shri Rewariji, MD of Morarjee Textiles Limited. Rewariji, let us start with 2017.
Yeah.
How was 2017 for the textile industry?
2017 was quite turbulent for the textile industries because of the major reforms undertaken by the economy, which has affected the trade segment, domestic segment of textile.
Right.
You know, the large textile which is being used by Indian consumers is either on the retail shop or it is in the mall.
Right.
So retail shop was existing in a so-called their own traditional economy, and all of a sudden there was a, I will call it, there was a disruption because of demonetization, and the second disruption came by way of GST. Both of these reforms, to our mind, in the long term, these are very good for the economy, nation, as well as all the trader community and we manufacturers.
Right.
But it has taken its own time, or it probably it will take its own time to settle down, and people will see merit into it, and happily people will adopt it. But till now, it's still, I will say that that part is still in a little bit of struggle zone. However, otherwise,
it's still in the transition phase.
It's still in the transition phase. We can't say that it is settled down. But the way government is supporting traders, and we have all round understanding of the trade at the textile minister level, and then at the finance minister level, it appears that the problems will be soon sorted out, because we see in Surat also now problems are less.
Right.
So we are passing through a turbulent phase, which probably we will have a very calm air in a due course of time.
So on the whole, 2017 post demonetization and post GST was a year of turbulence, especially for the textile industry.
Yeah.
With such a long supply chain.
Yeah.
And secondly, with the direct interaction with the retail customers, so that had an impact. The industry is still fighting to come out of it, and Rewariji hopes very soon we'll be out of it.
Yeah.
Regarding 2018, what do you say? I mean, how soon we will be?
I think 2018 will be much better than 2017 on two three accounts. One is that it appears that the organized retail in India will be consolidating themselves. As such, India is becoming now, after China, one of the great consumption centers.
Right.
So it's the biggest, after China, it is one of the biggest market for our merchandise, for everybody's merchandise.
Right, right.
So
we have an in-house consumption.
Yeah, so that is consolidating. We are seeing many national brands are taking deep and long strides into the people's pocket, and it looks that by and large, whatever we may lose on the unorganized economy, it will be recovered by the organized one.
Right.
And our cotton production, earlier the whatever trends we have were quite good, and we don't know how it shapes, but it's not as as volatile as it was in 2008 and in
2011.
Correct. So it looks situation looks much more predictable now.
Okay.
Then.
So predictable means manageable.
Manageable, there is nothing coming like
out of the blue.
Out of the blue, if the demand is slow, we know demand is slow.
Right.
So to me, it looks 2018. In textile, all years will be full of struggle. Sometimes less, sometimes more. So we can't be out of.
So you are used to that.
We have to be ready for that.
The 2017, we saw the initial part as far as exports were concerned were not so good for yarn exports.
Yeah.
September onwards, the exports started picking up. Our other mill friends have shared.
Yeah,
that's
right.
So, do you think this trend will continue in 2018?
I think so, but the demand of demand in exports will largely depend on China's policies. You know.
Right.
So if they
China's import policies.
If they import more, Indian export overall market will be very very vibrant and buoyant. But if China puts its foot back, so then I suspect, I fear, then it may not be that good, you know.
Correct. So China is a dominant importer of Indian cotton yarn. So if
I think
China
so.
Buying sustained,
yeah.
Then exports will grow.
Yeah, I think so, because of our you know coarser counts and other below 40 counts. I think the large exports are towards these countries, you know, seeing our Asian
right.
countries. So.
So
I don't know what is your view on this.
No, absolutely. I feel that for Indian prices to sustain at certain level is not in our hands.
Yeah.
But our demand to sustain is in China's hands.
China's
for sure.
Yeah.
They are very very dominant.
Their policies can force us to change our course, whether it is a cotton import by them.
Right.
Or it's an yarn import by
yes.
them. Both ways they can...
anything that they import,
they
is, going to
import is going to
affect demand
us.
In
yeah.
other market.
Yeah.
Sir, one question out of this context is like China was always India's dominant yarn by I think 2011,
yeah.
2014, 2016 years. And then suddenly Pakistan overtook India.
Yeah.
And now Vietnam has overtaken both India and Pakistan.
Mm.
So in this competitive scenario, where do you see India standing? Because India
yeah.
has an advantage of raw material being there in-house
yeah.
with us.
As you rightly mentioned, I mean, so we have to see that, understand one fact that India has now, India is now one of the largest producer of cotton.
Right.
India is, I think, today, India has most advanced spinning technology in the world.
India at par with the best in the world.
At par with the world, and so much of investment has gone into spinning sector. So. From quality point of view, I think there is nothing missing now in the Indian produce.
Right.
So, I think the crucial thing for Indian export to grow further will be how stabilized and at cotton prices are how stabilized and at par with the international prices, you know.
Right.
If they will remain higher than international prices, then it is going to affect the
exports.
It is the so that is one major point which should you know which in my view in the long term all these aberrations get settled down, maybe in terms of if we increase the yield per hectare, if we improve the quality of cotton, if we take care of contamination and other things,
right.
then your cost of production is also going to be less
yes,
and
productivity will improve, the cost
will improve. And then probably the cotton prices will be more predictable.
Right.
I am using the word predictable because the more unpredictable we are, more vulnerable we are in the
absolutely.
In the international world. And the buyer also doesn't like unpredictability. So we have to bring our country into a predictable zone so that the international buyers are not fearful and they don't look at India only as a commodity producer and then playing with that commodity and either gaining or losing is a matter of game.
Right.
So I think government, the trade, the industry itself have to help formulating policies in a manner that there is a less volatility and more
stabilization. So Rewariji strongly feel that we are very very competitive as far as technology is concerned, as far as quantum is concerned, we can supply any quantum of yarn that the world requires because the spinning industry is geared up for it. But what we lack is that in spite of having the advantage of raw material within the country, the variation or the fluctuation in prices is affecting the industry because they are not able to tap the market at the right time.
Price also and the quality also.
Quality also.
It's both linked.
No, we are a discounted cotton economy.
That's right.
So we sell 5 cents lower than any other origin of same specification.
That's right. So that has to be, that means the whole chain has to gear up.
Right. So two questions, Rewariji, arise out of this. One question is, now so much adulteration, contamination issues are being publicized for Indian cotton. Even the mills have been now quite vocal in saying that the cotton is much more contaminated than before in spite of TMC in place. What do you think is the reason and the solution
for it? I fully agree. This is the today's pain, not only for spinners but for the entire chain.
Right.
Even for fabric manufacturers also the contamination, I think it is much more this year than the last year.
Right.
Complaints are much more. I think TMC is one part, but this our maybe the general fraternity has to help the industry to, you know, adhere to some technological standards, some other standards, you know.
Right.
So I will urge them, request them to be a part of this textile growth in the country by at least taking whatever step they can take at their level, by technology, by, you know, their own checking. Let the, you know, let the original cotton go to the spinner.
Spinner.
Yeah. Rather than
in,
you know,
the same form that it comes from the field.
So it can't be like you know, toned milk and less toned milk and other milk. It has to, it has to go
as it is.
As it is.
Fiber, you know, quality is so
important. I hope you understand. You know that.
I'm absolutely.
Yeah. So it should go in a more organic way.
Right.
So then, I think nobody can beat India. Then, you know, and say these are. In India, we must understand that this textile business is a penny business. You know, it is not that you have huge margins or this thing. So small things help in saving.
The irony is, you invest in rupees, you earn in pennies.
That's right. You know, so that is the way it goes.
Correct.
So I think the contamination, adulteration, mixing. I'm say by design or by default or by ignorance, we don't know and we don't want to comment on that. But if it happens, it is going to affect ultimately the overall textile economy and its credibility and reliability in the market.
Right, because mills actually do not want to import.
Yeah.
They are compelled to import because what they have to deliver is quality.
Also tell me if we want 100% Australian cotton for white, you know.
Right.
So it's a big thing for us to maintain different cotton stocks for different type of products, you know.
Absolutely.
So plus I think the worldwide now the driver of the industry is going to be credibility, transparency,
right, consistency.
So these are the buzzwords of the business, you know.
Right.
And I add another word that, you know, it has to be reasonably profitable. You cannot aim to have unreasonable gains
in
by doing any hanky-panky thing.
Okay.
So that is not in favor of the industry.
Everybody is here to earn money, but you cannot earn at the cost of others.
Yeah,
so that is also, and not compromising on ethics.
Yeah, because I think the cotton, the more we have already, as a country, we have achieved a lot on the technological front. I remember a few decades back, some of the good companies were quite, you know, aggressive on the softer skills. But today, those skills are required, but not as much as during those days, because technology is now, you know,
taken over.
It's quite advanced. The labor cost is high, but the quotient of labor cost, I mean, say the number of people have been reduced for that matter for the same.
No, you can learn a ginning factory with only 5 people.
Yeah,
that
so
is
there is a lot of good things have happened, and we have to now plan that how we take this advantage to the marketplace and we allow Indian industry to grow.
Right.
And the most important thing is cotton. So that is very important.
We are still a cotton dominated spinning industry.
Yeah, and we are also observing some trends that maybe synthetic will also go up. If we see the data, the export of polyester or blends of garment from India has gone up.
Right.
By about in last 5-10 years at the rate of 20%.
Okay.
So this segment is
also growing.
So if we will not keep the character of the cotton in originality and in a proper shape, then these kind of
fibers will mount together,
and it is going to affect the farmers and agriculture economy accordingly.
Right.
So in a holistic view, we have to be very careful about all these things, you know. So
right.
First, let us make our country more recognized as a authentic supplier of textiles,
reliable, trustworthy supplier,
and then all things will fall into as we've seen, you know. If you are trustworthy, if you are reliable, I would say you get advantage of that in your retaining the customer, in profitability also, and it helps you in managing
sure,
your demand.
You are one of the priority because yeah. A trustworthy supplier is
it
always
helps you in managing your demand.
Absolutely.
So that way, I think since you are playing a very pivotal role in educating the community, cotton community and cotton users community by your various forums.
Yeah,
so
we
through you we want
every
to
yeah, stakeholder.
Yeah. So it's a good effort. We appreciate that. But we request you to educate more. Not educate, actually make them more aware about how these things will impact at the larger frame. You know.
Right.
Sometimes we do not realize that.
Realize the magnitude of. So Rewariji has pointed out two things. He is requesting the ginners, if you do not retain the originality of the cotton fiber for the spinners, for Indian spinners or say overseas buyers, two things can happen. One thing, either the mills will shift to other suppliers who are more reliable than you, or they may shift to other fibers. So in both cases, it's going to be a loss for the Indian ginners. So it's a very clear call. But Jesus complained that mills do not pay prices for good quality cotton. That is a common complaint I hear.
That could be right, but I think price is the phenomena of demand and supply. It is not in my hand today, you know, to control the cotton prices, and not even the bigger industries can control the cotton prices.
Right.
So it is these are the functions of the market.
Right.
So this perception is wrong that millers don't pay the price. Millers pay whatever is, if he wants to buy, he has to buy.
Yeah. So they will pay.
You have seen in India, you know, the per candy from 10,000 to 50,000, you know.
Correct.
In our own lifetime, we have seen 5-6 times growth.
Right.
This happens only in real estate, you know. We have seen it is happening
seen
in
it
the
in
cotton.
Commodity,
market.
Like cotton.
Yeah.
And then such vastly grown, it is
yeah.
not there, it's a niche produce.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is not a niche produce.
Yeah. We are the largest producer of the cotton.
Correct,
know.
In spite of that.
Yeah.
In even higher crop production year, we have seen the markets go up tremendously.
And since now technology to understand fiber is also quite adequately available, it should reduce the volatility, you know.
Right.
I am saying today gone are the days that this station is good, that station is good. What I need, I can find out, you know.
Absolutely.
That these parameters are good for me. These are coming from this station, that station, that station. So I should be okay with. I think these technological advances will help us in gaining more confidence, you know, what we are buying.
Right.
So that should also a little bit neutralize the volatility.
Volatility in prices.
Yeah.
Sir, you said that you would be always obviously looking out for good ginners or good suppliers of cotton. Similarly, good ginners would be looking out for good buyers like you who would buy and appreciate good quality. May not be in price, but in priority at least. So what do you think of the importance of a supply chain? Because in India, that term is not very commonly appreciated. A good supply chain, can it make a difference to
that? It can make much of the difference, you know. I mean, supply chain is a very integral part of our whole manufacturing, you know, the total manufacturing chain.
Right.
And also, I mean, supply chain is in my view, is very important. Today, if we are buying Pima cotton, you know, we can even without touching the fiber, we can keep on buying. You know, so nobody goes there and sees
the cotton physically.
That is the kind of credibility they have.
Right.
Now, in India, that model doesn't exist.
Absolutely. That is why they are able to demand such a premium. They are getting it. Still, the buyers are happy.
Yeah.
So, because of credibility.
Because ultimately, my own personal view is that. I'm saying fortunately or unfortunately, the ultimate price has to be borne by the consumer.
Right.
Nobody is going to, you know, invest in the products. Without getting the
consumer's consent,
or getting the right money for that.
From the consumer. Right.
So I think in Indian today, textile industry is quite mature. We need more trustworthy suppliers who can take care of all these logistic as well as quality and other things into their hand,
right.
And offer something, you know, trustworthy.
Right. So I think more professionalism would be welcome in this industry. Right?
But it is too fragmented and too small at this moment.
Correct, disoriented, right?
Yeah.
Second thing would be risk management. Now, like I shared with that Rajendar yesterday, he said 70% of Gujarat jeaners are today in very bad shape.
Mm.
So similarly, if mills, I was speaking to a very prominent mill in Tamil Nadu today morning, he said that more than 40% spinning mills are in very bad shape. They are only working with jeaners' money, they don't have their own capital.
Mm.
So, do you think risk management, like supply chain management, can make some difference today?
Of course, you know. In my view, if there is more volatility, the risk management is more required.
Absolutely. Because it is
required only for to counter the volatility. So, risk management is a very important tool, but I don't know actually. I am unable to comment on it because I don't know how well aware our the whole chain is about the risk management. I fear that the basic knowledge will be very less available.
I agree, technically they are not very they know that it is important, but somehow they are not.
Let's say if somebody is having a 25,000 spindle or 50,000 spindle stand alone unit, which are too many in our country, at that entrepreneur level, probably whether he has those skills or those tools with him to manage his risk properly,
right.
I am not aware, you know.
But do you think it should be?
It should be there, you know, because it's we do for our exports, imports also, you know, we hedge our foreign currency. So risk management is very important.
Especially in these times, there is fluctuation day in and day out.
We as a textile community should ensure that this risk management doesn't become another business, you know.
Right.
For some part of the
some
community. So that we have to
but
ensure.
As a practice, you...
As a practice, it's prevalent. It's prevalent. Everybody is hedging the, the foreign currency. Similarly, our raw materials, which
stocks
is about 60% of our cost, should
have. Because those who had stocks today, like New York fell by over 3 cents yesterday.
Yeah, yeah.
So, those who have unhedged stocks with them, now they would be facing very difficult
times.
Right.
I think it is a very important development, which has last 5-6 years we have seen it more activity on this front.
Right.
And maybe. As you and Kotex are more talking about this, it will gain more momentum and more understanding.
The more and more stakeholders come in, what happens? Some Now we have got the multinationals who are members. They are doing their bit. They don't keep a single bale open position. But if the Indian stakeholders become a part of it, then actually in their business, if they start to implement it in a small way also, they will realize that without that, what we are doing is totally risky business.
That's right.
So that is the good thing.
Second is maybe the availability of maybe cash flows, working capital could be another issue for people to hedge or not to hedge. You know, I mean, so the multinationals have a big
corpus
to right. play. You know, so maybe
they understand the importance that if they whatever corpus they have been built over so many years because they have. Manage the risk well.
Of course, you know.
So, if the risk was not managed at the initial part, like you said, a standard old spinning mill, if it doesn't, tomorrow it cannot expect to become an integrated composite textile mill.
Yeah,
so,
but I think there can be a cluster philosophy there, especially where 5-6 entrepreneurs are there. So, they can form a small community of themselves.
That's a very nice idea.
Yeah,
within themselves, they can.
Within themselves, they can. Plan, sit once a week and keep on sharing information with each other and experiences.
Right.
Because it as a habit, it is not existent.
Right.
So, if in order to make it a practice, we need
more interaction.
Because in our context,
groups which enjoys confidence with each other.
In our context, it happens only when we see others doing it.
Right.
So we are very comfortable in that. So I think in order to progress faster in this lane, if the entrepreneurs can form a joint, something like that.
Joint venture within a small group.
Within a small group, you know. And today with the WhatsApp technology and other things, information is quite this thing. But first is making themselves aware. The second is how it can help an enterprise. You know, this has to be
profitable,
and how it can save losses, right. Or how can it affect you if you do it? You know, so it is. Right. It has both ways.
Correct, effect. And that has to be tangible figures.
Yeah, so it's a sophisticated way of taking risk. You know,
right.
Taking risk to manage your risk.
Absolutely.
It's
taking a small risk to manage a bigger risk.
To manage a bigger risk. And once they start doing it and if they are convinced that yes, it is possible, probably this will gain more momentum.
So, Rewariji has enlightened so many things for us. One thing is that Indian economy is very robust. It can become more and more stronger if we follow the basic principles of trust, confidence, consistency with our consumers, our buyers. Second thing that supply chain is as important. Risk management is very important. And he, as a spinner, always looks out for people who are more, prone to supply good quality cotton. That brings the confidence in him. That's why he gave the example of Pima. He need not even see the sample.
Yeah.
And it's only done on males. So thank you, Rewariji.
Thank you
for your time. And our listeners will definitely
thank
appreciate
you very much
your
and keep this effort up. You know.
Thank you.
Thank you. In my view, the future of textile in India is very great. In order to achieve the bigger heights, I think we need to increase our marketing space. We are traditionally exporters to US and EU. I think now time has come and we need to spread our wings throughout on the entire globe. We have to find out different customers, different marketplaces where we can supply, and alongside we can also have a complete diversity in our product mix. We cannot be perceived only as a cotton fabric or apparel producers in other fibers also, and in the more fancy types of fabrics we need to grow. These markets, if we grow with our customers, if we grow with our markets, that will automatically give us not only the growth but also opportunities to understand that what more we can do to serve this markets well and better. It will also increase our, it will also, we will be able to achieve our the mission of bigger exports from India, and as well as give more profitability to all the textile industry. We are very happy to be associated with the Cotton Guru. Mr. Manish is a very knowledgeable and enlightening personality, which is helping the and one part of the cotton chain to be more aware about the raw material and its nuisances here and there. His efforts to share information in a very in a very philanthropic manner is very nice. We wish him all the best to Cotton Guru to help the industry more and more. Thank you.
Thank you.